Hey folks, John Belinsky here from See Me for Life, where our whole goal is to help you maximize your mind. Eastern Shore, I got your back, okay? I understand the dilemma. I understand what's going on. I understand what's going on with your PA school. We have a big test we got to take, and that's that upcoming Pack Rat. I know a number of you are going to join me in Baltimore for our Board of You course, and we're honored to have you, even if it's for the only 2 days, okay? We're going to make this extraordinary for you. This video is designed to optimize preparation before you come. Listen, watch this video, take notes on it, ask questions, but be ready with this knowledge before you walk in the door to optimize your day of learning. Information. Now, there's an infinite difference between information and understanding. Understanding. Our whole goal is to focus on understanding. So what I'm going to do with this video is give you the very important high-yield information from my live course, and I need you to study it before you walk in. You need to focus on this material. So please remember, on the NCCPA blueprint, there are 13 categories, and there's 551 pathologies that you have to know for your boards. Now, if you really want to own a topic, you have to ask and answer 4 questions. What's a pathophysiology? What's a presentation? How are you going to diagnose it, and how are you going to fix it? So if you really, really want to know cardiomyopathies, you have to say, well, what's the pathophysiology? You have to be able to answer that without looking at anything. You have to recall it. How are they going to present? So if someone's got a dilated cardiomyopathy, how are they going to present? What are they going to look like? What their vital signs are going to be? How are you going to figure it out? Now, 3 is diagnosis. How are you going to definitively diagnose it? Number 4 is, how do you fix it? Those are key questions. And you have to do it, guess what, for 551 topics on your boards. Oh, say, can you see? Oh, say, can you see? That is a mnemonic for the 4 types of kidney stones. Say, can you see? Struvite, calcium, uric acid, and cystine. There are 4 kidney stones. Oh, say, can you see? Struvite, calcium, uric acid, cystine. Listen, this is important. You have to know these terms. Chronotrope and ionotrope. Chronotrope and ionotrope. You have to know these terms. And you have to know it viscerally. Chronotrope is chronology. It's time. If I say a positive chronotrope, it makes the heart go faster. Positive chronotrope means the heart goes faster. Atropine is a positive chronotrope. A negative chronotrope makes the heart go slower. Beta blockers, calcium channel blockers, digoxin. They're negative chronotropes. Ionotropes means force of contraction. A positive ionotrope makes the heart beat harder. Digoxin is a positive ionotrope. A negative ionotrope makes the heart beat weaker. Beta blocker is a negative chronotrope. You have to know those terms. Know the anticholinergic side effects. Okay? Lots of medicines have them. Blind as a bat, mad as a hatter, dry as a bone, that means I'm holding a bone. Red as a beet, hot as heat. So, anticholinergic side effects, and atropine is a classic medicine in that class. Blind as a bat, mad as a hatter, dry as a bone, red as a beet, hot as heat. Blind as a bat means they have dilated pupils. Mad as a hatter, they become psychotic. Dry as a bone, they have no oral secretion. Urinary retention, constipation. Red as a beet, they get flushed. Hot as heat, they can have a malignant hyperthermia. Vagus nerve. Now, the vagus nerve, listen. The vagus nerve's job is to slow down the heart. Okay, the sympathetic nervous system is like epinephrine. It's an adrenaline rush. The vagus nerve's job is to slow down the heart. It's parasympathetic. I call it the after-sex response. The, whoo, oh my gosh, I'm so relaxed. You stimulate the vagus nerve, they become super, super, super relaxed. I think of it as, here's epinephrine, here is the parasympathetic nervous system. This is driven by the vagus nerve. I think of this as a dog, pit bull, this is a leash. The vagus nerve, if it pulls down, the dog's submissive. If you cut the leash, the dog's gonna go crazy. So if we cut or block the vagus nerve, the heart's gonna speed up. That's atropine. Okay, if we stimulate the vagus nerve, either through adenosine or vagal maneuvers, it's gonna slow down the heart. Now listen. There are 3 major medicines when it comes to ACLS that start with A. Atropine, adenosine, and amiodarone. Atropine, adenosine, amiodarone. Okay? The second letter of each word gives away what it does. Atropine, the T stands for tachycardia. Okay? Adenosine, the D stands for down. It slows down the heart. The M for amiodarone means it mellows it out. It's an antiarrhythmic, okay? Now, amiodarone, we don't say amiodarone. We're going to say amiodarone. We wink. Amiodarone, because it's a mnemonic within the word, because the toxicities of amiodarone are optic neuritis, thyroid disease, hepatitis, pulmonary fibrosis. That's important. Cardiomyopathies, I think of it like a guy greeting you. Like when I greet another guy, there's four ways they can greet me. And mistakes that can happen. If I greet them with a handshake, if I don't get their webbing well, I have a weak, floppy handshake. Okay? If someone really wants to prove how strong they are, they can squeeze my hand super hard so I can get a muscular, bulky handshake. Someone could say, no, I don't want a handshake. I want a hug. So they give me a squeezing handshake. Or sometimes guys will just jump out, hi! Oh my gosh, freak me out. So there's four cardiomyopathies. Floppy or dilated cardiomyopathy, a bulky, which is hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy, restrictive, and if someone gets scared, it's called broken heart syndrome. We call that Takotsubo's cardiomyopathy, okay? Now there's four findings, four things I want you to think about for CHF. One and two. One and two have to do with the superior and inferior vena cava. Now, if the heart has got CHF, right heart failure, it's going to back up fluid. It's going to back up fluid to their superior vena cava and inferior vena cava. So if you back up fluid up the superior vena cava, they get JVD. If you back up fluid down the inferior vena cava, they're going to get hepatic engorgement or hepatojugular reflex, ascites, and edema. So one, JVD. Two, hepatic engorgement, ascites, edema. Three is going to be cardiac findings. And the big thing I need you to think about is an S3 and a mitral regurg murmur. And number four is they're going to have pulmonary symptoms. They're going to have cough, shortness, breath, wheezing, dyspnea, exertion, and redistribution symptoms, meaning that when they lay down flat at night, their intravascular volume goes up. So they're going to be coughing at night. They're going to have to pee more at night, okay? Now, if you look at this chart in front of you, this chart is called Klaus's Clarification after a PA that came to one of my conferences and said, John, I want to show you this mnemonic, and it was really helpful. I love it when people come to my conferences with ways to memorize complicated material. So if you go by the pH, normal pH is 7.4 for your boards. Is it higher or lower? Alkalotic or acidotic? And then you got to go to carbon dioxide using the base normal of 40. Is it greater than or less than 40? If so, the mnemonic is Mr. Ronald McDonald. So the blue boxes is M, the red triangles are R, metabolic or respiratory. And then the green boxes there show what's bicarb going to do. So for acid base on your boards, and we'll cover this more at the live course, folks, pH is 7.4, carbon dioxide is 40, bicarb is 24. And based on this chart, this Klaus's clarification, you'll have a very good idea of what's going on with acid base. Now, when it comes to murmurs, the way I teach it, in South Vietnam, there are still MIAs. What am I saying? The most common systolic murmurs are MIAS, mitral insufficiency aortic stenosis. Please be ready for your test. Know that insufficiency might be called regurgitant. So it's mitral insufficiency or mitral regurg. Then on the bottom, I'm saying if I aims a gun at you, you're going to die. If I aims a gun at you, you're going to die. Aortic insufficiency, mitral stenosis. Those are the most common diastolic murmurs, okay? No Beck's triad. Beck's triad is for pericardial effusion, okay? It's a sequelae either from trauma or from pericarditis. Beck's triad is JVD, muffled heart sounds, and hypotension, okay? Or the real thing is pulsus paradoxus. Don't worry about that, but the one review book says hypotension. But JVD, I want you to think of three pathologies, CHF, pericardial tamponade, or tension pneumo. Now listen. What's the difference between a simple pneumo and a tension pneumo? Shock. If they're in shock, it's a tension. If they're not in shock, it ain't a tension. Shock means altered mental status, hypotension, and they look like they're going to crash. Okay? Beck's triad. Now, atrial fibrillation. Now, if you hate arrhythmias, you got to know them. You got to know two of them at least. You got to know AFib and VTAC. Okay? AFib, diagnostic criteria is narrow complex, and there's an asterisk there because for the boards it will be narrow, but sometimes clinically it can be wide. Okay? No P waves, always irregular. I need you to be able to recall that. As soon as you walk in the class, if I say, what's the diagnostic criteria for AFib? Narrow complex, always irregular, no P waves. Know that with atrial fibrillation, we have three things we need to think about for treatment. I need to slow it down if it's greater than 100. I need to prevent BBs from being shot out. So I have to prevent embolization. And then I have to say, can I convert it back to sinus rhythm? Okay, what's the most common arrhythmia? It's AFib. So three modalities that I have to treat AFib for. Slow it down, prevent embolization, and go, can I convert it back? Now I want you to know the CHADS-2 score. CHADS-2 score means if they have a CHADS-2 of 2 or greater, it means an INR of 2, meaning they have to be thinned. CHADS, C-H-A-D-S, congestive heart failure, hypertension, age greater than 75, diabetes, or stroke. And stroke is 2 points. Counts, TAA counts. So if someone's ever had a TAA and now they're in new AFib, they have a CHADS of 2 and they got to be put on anticoagulation. If someone has a CHADS of 1, they get put on aspirin. Now, if you look at this box in front of you, you see the pathway of a dying heart. That goes from VTAC to VFib to asystole. Now, in that box, that's what I can shock. I can do an unsynchronized shock of VTAC and VFib. Then they live. They live. It's the most cool thing I've ever done in medicine is shock someone back to life. I've been privileged in my time as a hospitalist working in the ICU and running an ER to take care of hundreds of codes. And to shock someone out of a lethal arrhythmia is awesome. Now, VTAC, this is a very common question that I ask and the boards are going to ask you. How do you treat VTAC? It's a trick question because there's three treatments. The big thing is I would ask, well, how does VTAC present clinically? And I call it a Bon Jovi song. It's like a Bon Jovi song. I say VTAC is my Bon Jovi rhythm. And why? Well, because these people, they present dead or alive. Now, the dead rhythms need unsynchronized shock. I'll tell you what that means in a second. Dead people get unsynchronized shock. Alive people, well, wait. If they're alive, I need to know, are they alive and stable or alive and unstable? Now, what makes a patient unstable? They're super sick. They're going to die in 5 minutes if you don't do anything. So the board question is going to be diaphoretic, hypotension, altered mental status. If you have that, you better shock them. But it's a synchronized shock, okay? Synchronized shock. What does that mean versus unsynchronized? The R&T phenomenon. When they talk about the R&T phenomenon or the QRS, QRS, the R wave is a big bolt of electricity. It's the big beat of your heart. The R wave is the aggressive jolt. So I'd like you to think of the R wave as a shock. Now, if we shock somebody with our paddles, that's an R wave. We're giving them an R wave. If we hit them on the T wave, we kill them. So why do we care about that? Well, if they have no pulse, I don't care. I don't care where it's synchronized. It can be unsynchronized because if I shock them in the T wave, I don't care. They're already dead. I can't kill somebody who's dead, but I can kill someone who's alive. So if someone's having a pulse but they're sick and I need to shock them, I have to synchronize it to avoid the R&T phenomenon. What's the key principle of treating any unstable arrhythmia? Synchronized cardioversion. Now, heart blocks are relative to the PR interval. There's 4 different heart blocks. First degree heart block is a long PR interval, and that's greater than 5 small boxes or 0.20. A Winkey Bock or a Mobitz 2 type 1 is growing, dropped. A Mobitz type 2 is a fixed PR interval, and a Mobitz 3, there is no connection. There's no PR interval. No measurable PR interval. It's because it's constantly varying. There's no communication. So there's really 3 heart blocks, 1, 2, and 3. 1, all beats are getting through. 2, some of the beats are getting through. 3, no beats are getting through. And we know there's 2 different type 2s. Type 1, Winkey Bock. Type 2 is a Mobitz type 2. Now, going into CHF a little bit more, know there's right heart failure and left heart failure. The right heart failure stands for roads. What roads lead to the heart? The superior vena cava and inferior vena cava. So if you back up congestion down the roads, right heart failure is going to be JVD. Hepatojugular reflex ascites edema. Left heart failure is lungs. They're going to have dyspnea on exertion, shortness of breath, and rails in their lungs. Now, again, looking at this picture here, so right heart failure is JVD, hepatojugular reflex ascites edema. Left heart failure, they have pulmonary symptoms, cough, shortness of breath, dyspnea on exertion, fatigue. Redistribution symptoms. These are people that become sicker when they lay down. So they're going to want to sleep on more pillows. They're going to wake up coughing. They're going to want to pee more at night because of the increased intravascular volume. Okay? Now, there's 5 causes of chest pain. I teach it as who's your papa? Who's your papa? Who's your papa? P-A-P-P-A. It's mnemonic. First off, clinically, there's no exception to it. On the boards, there's not going to be an exception to it. Someone comes in with chest pain, I want you to think P-A-P-P-A. It's a dance. P-A-P-P-A. pericarditis, acute coronary syndrome, pneumothorax, PE, aneurysm, thoracic dissection. What are the risk factors for arterial disease? The mnemonic is SAD CHF. Whew, that's a sad case of CHF. Smoking, age, diabetes, cholesterol, hypertension, family history. Listen, please listen. The diseases of the arterial system are different than the diseases of the venous system. Arterial risk factors are SAD CHF. Venous risk factors, DVT, PE, are Virchow's triad. I'm going to talk about that coming up, Virchow's triad, but that's stasis, hypercoagulable state, and damage to or near blood vessel. Wolff Parkinson's White. If you look at this picture in front of you, Wolff Parkinson's White, that black line is a super fast road, and impulses want to go down that accessory pathway. If you use a funnel drug, that red funnel, that funnel represents a negative chronotrope, like a beta blocker, calcium channel blocker, or digoxin. If you use a funnel drug on a patient with WPW, their heart rate's going to go faster because more impulses will go down that accessory pathway. Okay? Know that ankylosing spondylitis and Reiter syndrome both have the HLA-B27 antigen. Okay? Be ready for that. HLA-B27, ankylosing spondylitis, and Reiter syndrome. And one thing about ankylosing spondylitis, typically it happens in 30-year-old guys. I'd like you to think of a 30-year-old guy. You take his head off. You take a light tube. You know those light tubes, those long tubes? You replace his spine with that light tube and put his head back on. Very, very brittle spine. A little jostly breaks his back. Now, a big question on the boards is, we don't ever want to tell a patient to live a sedentary lifestyle. We want them to be active, but we want them to be safe. We don't want them to run because they could fall. We don't want to ride a bike. They'll fall off their bike and break their back. We want them to do something super safe. Swimming. Get in a pool. Swimming. Know that for meniscal tears, the tests are McMurray and Apley. Meniscal tears, McMurray and Apley. ACL tears, Lachman's. Okay. Multiple myeloma. Watch, look at this picture. We know that multiple myeloma has bone pain that leads to high calcium levels and high protein levels in the blood. That leads the protein to go to the kidney, where they can go into acute renal failure and they pee out Bench-Jones proteins. That's multiple myeloma. Gout versus pseudo-gout. Know that gout has the rod-shaped crystals that are negatively, beneficently charged or deflecting light, where pseudo-gout is positively, beneficent charged and they're rhomboid-shaped. So remember, gout, rod-shaped and negative, pseudogout is positive and rhomboid. Streptococcus. So a recent strep infection, we would check an ASO titer. That's going to be important for a kid that presents peeing out protein, and they're going to say tea-colored urine. Strep pyogenes or beta-hemolytic strep, and what diseases does strep throat cause? Rheumatic fever, glomerulonephritis, scarlet fever, and PANDAS is pediatric autoimmune neuropsychiatric disorders associated with strep. So strep has been linked to Tourette's, and we don't really know why, okay? And Campylobacter, we know, has been linked to Guillain-Barré syndrome. Don't really know why. Okay, we know the cryptorchism, undescended testicles, are linked to torsion and testicular cancer. Cryptorchism, if they say that on the boards, remember, torsion is an acute presentation, cancer is a gradual presentation. Look here that if you have a testicle that's swollen. It could be swollen for one of three reasons. I mean, there's other reasons too, but Hydroseal and Spermatoseal, they both transilluminate. Varicoseal will not. And remember, Varicoseal changes with Valsalva, but they describe it as a bag of worms. So Varicoseal, the V stands for it's very dark and very wormy. Okay, Varicoseal. Centers criteria. Centers criteria looks for strep throat, CENT, cough, exudates, nodes, temp, or maybe they have mono. Remember, strep should not cough. Strep should be red hot poker on the throat. Shouldn't go on lower than that. Or maybe they have mono, okay? Think about that. Now, what is the most common bug that causes endocarditis in IV drug users? Staph aureus. What are the four classic findings of endocarditis? Rough spots, splinter hemorrhages, Osler's nodes, Janeway lesions. What am I saying is Rough spots, retina. Here. Then splinter hemorrhages. We got that, and then the hand. The way I want to think about it is, why did O.J. Simpson get off? It's because of the glove. The glove, right? If it don't fit, you must have quit, right? O.J. Osler's nodes, Janeway lesion. So what are you looking for endocarditis? Rough spots, splinter hemorrhages, Osler's nodes, Janeway's lesions. Cool? Clostridium comes in four flavors. Clostridium is a gram-positive anaerobic spore former. Clostridium causes difficile, perfringens, tetani, and botulinum. It causes four diseases. Difficile, perfringens, tetani, botulinum. There are three atypical germs. Okay? Three atypicals. CML, pneumonic, chlamydia, mycoplasma, legionella. They're small like viruses, but they have a cell wall. So I can kill it with antibiotics. I can kill it with macrolides, fluoroquinolones, or doxycycline. Okay? Neisseria, if you look at this picture in front of you, Neisseria is a gram-negative diplococci. Gram-negative diplococci. Gram-negative diplococci is Neisseria. Listen, gram-positive diplococci is strep pneumoniae. Okay? Now, gram-negative diplococci causes two diseases. One, think about that one coffee bean drinking coffee and it's very jittery. Meningitis. So Neisseria causes meningitis. Also, Neisseria causes gonorrhea. So please understand for your boards, if they say gonococcal urethritis, it means there's gram-negative diplococci in their urethral smear. If they say they did a gram stain but there's nothing there, they're going to call it non-gonococcal urethritis, and that's a code word for chlamydia. Okay, non-gonococcal urethritis is a code word for chlamydia. Know that anybody with pneumonia, you have to know where they got sick. Is it community-acquired or hospital-acquired? MASH and PEAS is a mnemonic. MASH for community acquired. Moxidilla catarrhalis, atypical strep pneumonia, H flu. Hospital acquired is PEAS, Pseudomonas, E. coli, anaerobes, and staph. You have to know basic spectrum of penicillins. Basic penicillin kills strep only, and that is it. The beta-lactamase penicillin, the mnemonic is imetanastiox. Methicillin, nafcillin, oxacillin. And it'll kill staph, but it will not kill MRSA because it got smarter. It's called methicillin-resistant staph aureus. The aminopenicillins cover gram-negatives and positives, but no staph. So aminos are amoxicillin and ampicillin. Wonderful like otitis media. Adding clavulanic acid will kill staph. Not MRSA, but we call that augmentin. For your boards, I want you to think it's called dogmentin. 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 Dogmentin is amoxicillin and clavulanic acid, okay? Great for any bites. Any bites. All the bites are Ellas. 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 A bite is an Ella. If it's a cat or dog, it's Pastorella. Think of the dog and the cat running in a pasture. Oh, it's so cute. They're running. Pastorella. If it's from a tooth of a human, the guy's name is Ike. Ike, big beefy guy. He's giving you crap. Ike's giving you, poosh, you punch him in the tooth and it cuts your hand. So now you have Ike and Ella. Ike and Ella. We know that gentamicin, think about the gentleman boxer. And he's not a nice boxer. He's not a gentleman. As soon as the ref's not looking, he'll go and box you on the ears and punch you in the kidney. So we know gentamicin is ototoxic and nephrotoxic. We know that vancomycin, think about taking a van that you want to convert into an ambulance. You put a big plus sign on it. Vancomycin is only for gram positives. Vancomycin is wonderful for MRSA, but it's also wonderful for C. diff, oral. Remember, it's got to be oral. Really, really sick C. diff patient, they need oral vancomycin. INH, isoniazid. Isoniazid, INH. I need B6. Pyridoxamine deficiency goes with isoniazid. N is neuropathy, and H is hepatitis. Also know that there's a duck there. That duck is there because INH will give you a Maillard rash. Isoniazid is one of six medicines that will give you a lupus-like rash, okay? Peridium and rifampin, both of them will turn secretions reddish-orange, okay? Ethambutol, don't worry about it, just know it can give you optic neuritis. Ethambutol gives you optic neuritis. Anybody with pulmonary symptoms, you don't want to make a horrid mistake on your boards. There are only five causes of shortness of breath on your boards. Is it cardiac, obstructive, reactive infection, or death from a PE pneumothorax? I give you a hint, that's very clinical too. These mnemonics I developed for clinical practice, but they also translate over to board review, okay? There are three lung sounds on your boards. I mean, Strider is one too, but we're not going to count that one for now. If they say ronchi, it means gook in the big airways. If they say rails or crackles, it's fluid in the small airways. If they say wheezing, it means the small airways are clamped down. So wheezing means they need bronchodilators or steroids. If I take my two fingers and go like this and push on my upper airway, I'm giving myself croup. And that's steeple sign. If you look at the x-ray there and those white arrows, that's pointing towards croup. Croup is also known as laryngotracheitis. epiglottitis. I'd like you to think of this. If you've ever intubated someone with epiglottitis, their epiglottis is like, you shouldn't. I mean, it's very risky, but you have a big stalk. That stalk, if they move their head around, it chokes off their airway. So the patient's going to be leaning forward on extended arms with their head tilted back because they're balancing their epiglottis to keep it open. They call that the tripod position. Surgical emergency. Now, why don't we see epiglottitis anymore? Well, because of the HIB vaccine. So the question may be something like, why is a life-threatening throat infection no longer seen? Is it aggressive use of antibiotics or vigorous hand washing or pediatric immunizations? Now, if you look at this picture right here, you see a square and a bunch of oats. They're right in the center of the chest, okay? That square is squamous cell cancer. That oat is oat cell cancer. They're both central, so they'll spit up blood. Both of those have hemoptysis. Adenocarcinoma does not. It's peripheral. Adenocarcinoma is on your boards, always the cell that you pick. If you're not sure what cancer in the body is most common, always pick adeno, okay? If you look right here, that plus sign means adenocarcinoma. That null sign means no hemoptysis, and that yellow arrow means it likes to mets to the liver. That's why it's such a poor prognosis with adenocarcinoma, because if someone's spitting up blood, they're coming in early. Know that emphysema has got three different diagnostic kind of pathophysiological problems. You have anatomy problem, physiology problem, and historical problem, meaning that emphysema is dead airspace, reactive airway disease is the asthma component, and chronic bronchitis is enlarged goblet cells. Okay. We talked about venous risk factors earlier, venous risk factors. Now, if we're talking about pulmonary embolism, I want to give you a dance. Know that there's five things that I want you to think. It's called the PERC rules, pulmonary embolism rule out criteria, where the dance looks like this. A 1, 2, 3, 4. Then I hit my leg. Five things going into the PERC rules. V, V, bam, bam, leg. Five things. V, V is vital signs and Virchow's triad. If I'm looking for PE, I'm looking for tachycardia and hypoxia. If I'm looking at Virchow's triad, I'm thinking, are they clotty? Damage, stasis, hypercoagulable state. Bam, bam. Hemoptysis, if they're spitting up blood, that's sinister. The thing down here is age range. That's not specific for the boards. Know that these particular rules are clinical, but if the person's greater than 50, you can't use it. And then I'm whacking my legs saying, if they have signs of deep venous thrombosis, I'm going to be thinking PE. And PE, it's really hinged on the diagnosis. The treatment's easy. They're getting anticoagulated or a filter, an inferior vena cava filter. Now, please remember for your boards, if they say hemoptysis, think three things, okay? Think cancer, oat cell, or squamous cell. Think PE, or if they say something about unexplained hemoptysis in a kid, they swallowed a foreign body. It's classic of a kid who's crawling. They're crawling on the floor. Everything is beautiful, wonderful, though healthy. Next thing you know, they're coughing. They have unilateral lung sounds. They're spitting up blood. They need a bronchoscopy because they swallowed something. Okay? So Virchow's triad, remember, damage, stasis, hypercoagulable state, DSH, damage, stasis, hypercoagulable state. This image right here is of Amsel's garden, Amsel's garden, Amsel's garden. There's four things in the garden. You have clue cells, the whiff test, a pitcher, which is a pH, and some discharge, that milk. So know that Amsel's garden is for Gardnerella or bacterial vaginosis, and you're looking for four things. Clue cells, positive whiff test, which is amine coming off of potassium hydroxide off a vaginal smear. pH, it's higher than 4.7, and the discharge is a whitish gray that adheres to the speculum. Now, two things you got to be ready to compare and contrast, abrupto placentae and placentae previa. Know that abrupt, it's an abrupt tear. It's an abrupt tear, and it hurts. So abrupto placentae is pain, placenta tears. If it's placenta previa, there's no pain, and the placenta is just covering the ass, okay? What is contraindicated in a patient with placenta previa? Well, intercourse, but also digital exam, okay? If you look at this image here, you see a normal squamous cell that points to a columnar cell. That is known as Barrett's esophagus, and if you look at the red hatch marks around it, it's premalignant. Now, if you look at the red hatch marks at the distal esophagus, we know that Barrett's esophagus is from acid splashing. So it's always distal esophagus. The problem is that can be converted to adenocarcinoma. So please remember, normal squamous cell transforms into columnar epithelium known as Barrett's. It transforms into adenocarcinoma. Now, if you look at this picture here, Kress syndrome. Kress syndrome goes like this. Kress syndrome is a part of scleroderma. If you see that penny with the X in it, that means that anticentromere is used to diagnose limited scleroderma. CREST syndrome, CREST. So I'm taking Crest toothpaste on my tooth, then I'm taking off my tooth, putting it on my hand, then I'm rubbing it on my neck, then I'm taking it, putting it on this hand, then I'm putting it on my nose. CREST syndrome. Calcinosis, Raynaud's, esophageal dysmotility, sclerodactyly, telangiectasia. So CREST syndrome is a part of scleroderma. Now, if you look at this picture here, this is Plummer-Vincent syndrome. Plummer-Vincent syndrome is like a plumber that comes to fix your iron toilet. And the plumber walks in your house, named Vincent, Plummer-Vincent. He puts up his fingernail. He reaches behind your toilet. He pulls out a spider web. He takes that spider web, puts it on his tongue, and then he throws it. And it scratches going all the way down. So Plummer-Vincent syndrome is fingernail, web, glossitis, dysphagia. So Plummer-Vincent is spoon nails or colonicchia, esophageal webs, glossitis, and dysphagia. Okay? There are 5 fingernail findings you need to know for your boards. We already talked about 2 of them. We have colonicchia is 1. We have splinter hemorrhages, which is 2. Onychomycosis, which is fungal. Psoriasis, which is pitting. And then the last one is clubbing, which stands for long-standing pulmonary disease. Now, if we look at this image here, H. pylori causes 3 things in the stomach. It causes lymphoma, ulcers, and adenocarcinoma. We can diagnose H. pylori with a bunch of different testing. Just know that if you treat someone with H. pylori and you want to retest them to see if it's gone, you got to wait 4 weeks. Rantzen's criteria is used to diagnose, well, it's not necessarily to diagnose, but it's to prognose pancreatitis. The mnemonic I came up with it is gall and ETOH. So when someone presents gall, gallstones are one of the most common causes for pancreatitis. Glucose, age, leukocytosis, and liver functions. So I'm going to look for that when they present. Is their glucose greater than 200? Are they older? Do they have a big white count? And then at 24 to 48 hours, ETOH. I want to look at their electrolytes. Are they dropping calcium? Are they third spacing fluid? Are they becoming hypoxic? Are they becoming anemic? So that's Rantzen's criteria of pancreatitis. Now, there are 12 different causes of diarrhea for our boards. There's lots of different causes, but I wanted to come up with the most specific buzzwords to try to help you, okay? Know that Staph aureus is super rapid onset, 1 to 7 hours. Giardia, we treat with metronidazole. Cyclospora, we treat with Bactrim, trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole, and we know that purulent diarrhea, Salmon E. coli went camping in the Shig. Salmonella, E. coli, Campylobacter, Shigella. Salmonella, a buzzword there is, sickle cell patients love to get Salmonella osteomyelitis, and Campylobacter we know is linked to Guillain-Barré syndrome. If you look at this picture right here, you see a crow standing on a cobblestone fence and you're holding up your fist saying, hey, get off my fence. So we know that Crohn's disease has brown diarrhea, not much blood, cobblestoned appearance on colonoscopy, and they like to have fistulas and abscesses. Now, if you look at the compare and contrast here between Crohn's and ulcerative colitis, know that Crohn's is full thickness inflammation. It goes all the way through fistulas, abscesses. Skip areas are common. It's more common on the right side, diarrhea without blood. The surgery doesn't fix them. It just treats complications as opposed to ulcerative colitis. You see, it's mucosal thickness only. There's no skip areas, blood, lots of blood. Surgery would fix them. If you take out the diseased portion of bowel, they're fixed. Now, if you look at this image in front of you right now, you see the crow is on the right side. So Crohn's disease is more common right-sided pain. Ulcerative colitis is more common on the left side. That prom dress is for appendicitis, P-R-O-M, P-SOAS sign, O-obturator sign, R-Rothsing sign, and M is McBurney's point. And that nun right at the belly button is a Sister Mary Joseph nodule that is linked to adenocarcinoma. Now, there are 3 different patterns on the x-ray of the abdomen. So you have boxing gloves, parachutes, and slinkies. Boxing gloves, which represents a volvulus, parachutes, which represents ileus, and the slinkies are represented by bowel obstruction. Dermatologic terms, DAN, 3 signs that I want you to know on this slide. Derriere sign is if you rub your butt, you get allergic hives. So derriere sign is if you rub a lesion and you get allergic raised lesions. That's derriere sign. Auschwitz sign, I'd like you to think of Auschwitz and the concentration camps, and the prisoners were held inside a building where they had scales on them. You pull a scale off, and there's pinpoint bleeding. That's Auschwitz sign. You remove a scale, pinpoint bleeding. And then Nikolsky sign, think of a guy named Nick who's skiing. He hits a mogul, and the mogul doesn't pop, but it spreads the snow away from the ground. That's ominous. A Nikolsky sign is pushing on a blister, causing further separation of the dermis. Next one is Koebner's phenomenon. Koebner's phenomenon, like the Keebler elf. The Keebler elf rips a piece of paper. Koebner phenomenon means minor trauma leads to a new lesion at the site of the trauma. Koebner's phenomenon. Okay, lichen planus. Oh, I like that plane. Oh, I like that plane. I like that plane. Lichen, I like that purple plane. I like the purple plane. Lichen planus has the four P's, purple, polygonal, papular, and pleuritic. Okay, and if you look at those white lines on the side of the plane and the C on its nose, we know that Wickham striae are these white lines, and look for hepatitis C in patients with lichen planus. Now, Wernicke's encephalitis, know that Wernicke's, which is typically a thiamine deficiency, is a lazy eye, I can't walk, and confused. Wernicke's is walking. Wernicke's, they can't walk. They have a lazy eye and they're confused. Risk of suicide, this will be on the boards. Sad persons. Male, sex. We kill each other more. You know, females try it more, they attempt it more, males are more successful. Age, young and old, depression, previous attempt, substance abuse, ETOH and substance abuse. Rational thought loss, social support lacking. Do they have a plan? No spouse, or are they sick? As people become increasingly sick, their chances of committing suicide are higher. Microcytic anemias. I hope these stick. I hope these stick with you. I hope these stick. There's four causes of microcytic anemia. Now, chronic disease is a diagnosis of exclusion, but sideroblastic thalassemia and iron deficiency. I hope those stick with you. Those are the four causes of iron deficiency anemia. Please remember that sideroblastic rings are seen in three cases: iron, alcohol, and isoniazid. Sideroblastic rings are seen in three cases: iron, alcohol, isoniazid. Basophilic stippling are seen in lead and thalassemias. Basophilic stippling. So please remember, lead gives you sideroblastic rings and basophilic stippling. There are four labs to look for iron deficiency anemia. So that's pumping iron, TIBC and transferrin, serum iron and ferritin. And please understand this. Listen, this is important. If someone's iron deficient, ferritin and serum iron are going to be low, but TIBC and transferrin are going to be high. That's the normal finding. So TIBC and ferritin will be high, iron and serum ferritin will be low. If you look at this picture in front of you, we know that ferritin locks in the diagnosis. Ferritin is like a hemoglobin A1C. It's like a three-month iron, if you will, okay, where serum iron is kind of like glucose and triglycerides. It varies rapidly based on what you just ate over the last few hours. AML versus CML. AML, that A stands for our rods. AML is linked to our rods, where CML is linked to Philadelphia chromosome. Okay? If you look at this picture here, this has to do with the eyelid itself. I was always confused, Chalazion versus Hordeolum. Know that a chalet is off the eyelid. It's painless, it's calm, it's up in the mountains. So we know Chalazion is painless and off the border, where Hordeolum is on the road, painful, okay? If you look at this picture here, and you remember the movie Castaway, Tom Hanks kind of talked to Wilson, okay? Wilson's disease is excess copper. That's what the pennies are for, and is linked to Kaiser-Fleischer rings of the eye. Weber test, please, while you're watching this, I want you to do this so you understand. Weber test. I want you to close your eyes and hum. So you're going to close your eyes and go, and say, which ear did you hear the vibration loudest in? And you should say both. So you take your pinky and or your pointer finger and put it in your ear. Now close your eyes and hum. Well, you hear it way louder in the ear with your finger in. So with a conductive hearing loss, Weber is going to go to that side. So that's just a poor man's Weber test. There are three causes of peripheral vertigo: BPPV, a virus, and fluid. So there's stones, viruses, and fluids. BPPV is benign paroxysmal positional vertigo. What it is, I'd like you to think of a little stone in a snow globe. You shake the snow globe, the stone floats around. It takes 1 minute for the stone to settle. That's BPPV. They turn their head quickly. Horrible vertigo. Goes on for 1 minute. Vestibular neuritis is a virus, where Meniere's is fluid. Fluid fills up. If you look at this picture in front of you, this is about thyroid disease. You have hyperthyroid, thyroiditis, and hypothyroid. So hyperthyroid is Graves' disease and De Quer pains. It's not really De Quer pains. It's De Quer veins, but I say De Quer pains because guess what? It's the only cause of a painful thyroid. And the also thing is De Quer veins is linked to De Quer veins tenosynovitis. And the test for De Quer veins is if you take the fist, put the thumb in first and make a fist, that's a really bad fist, and you bend their fist down. I call it the bad fist test. It's known as the Finkelstein test. Finkelstein, De Quer veins, tenosynovitis, Finkelstein, okay? So itises are Hashimoto's. That CAR stands for Hashimoto's. Think this, ladies and gentlemen. Hashimoto's is hypothyroidism. Graves is hyper. And the mountains down there, that stands for Himalaya mountains, that stands for Hashimoto's iatrogenic, meaning that we cause hypothyroidism. M is medications like amiodarone, and L is lithium. This picture is the triad for diabetes. Honey, dun, 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 dun. Aw, sugar, sugar. If someone's hyperglycemic, polyuria, polyphagia, polydipsia. Now, in the movie Star Wars, there was a movie R2-D2. When it comes to diabetes, I want you to think of the robot R2-F3. How do we diagnose diabetes? Well, random blood sugar greater than 200. 2 is a 2-hour glucose tolerance test. F is a fasting blood sugar greater than 126. 3 is a 3-month sugar or hemoglobin A1C. It's greater than 6.5. So how do we diagnose diabetes? R2-F3. If you look at this slide, you have the dawn phenomenon, Somogyi effect. Now, this is someone who wakes up in the morning and their blood sugar is high, 300. It's from one of two mechanisms. The dawn phenomenon, as the sun comes up, blood sugar goes up. Cool. The treatment there is you got to give them a higher dose of insulin before they go to bed. Now, the Somogyi effect is where blood sugar drops. What happens when blood sugar drops, counter-regulatory hormones kicks in to jack up blood sugar. Those counter-regulatory hormones are cortisol, growth hormone, and glucagon, okay? When that happens, the body's like, oh, crap, we got to bring blood sugar up. What happens is they got too much insulin before they go to bed. Their blood sugar drops, and their body's like, whoa, if you don't get higher blood sugar, you're going to die. So the treatment regime for Somogyi effect is to decrease NPH before they go to bed to stop that hypoglycemic event. BUN creatinine, if BUN and creatinine are up, you got to say, is it pre-renal, renal, or post-renal? Normal BUN is about 20, creatinine is about 1, okay? If I go sit in a sauna for an hour and take 80 of Lasix, my BUN will go to 40, my creatinine will go to 1.2, 1.3. BUN is very volatile, creatinine is very steady state. So if I go into a sauna, take 80 of Lasix, but I also go on an anti-inflammatory medicine and an ACE inhibitor, my BUN will go to 40, my creatinine will go to 4. That ratio is much higher than 20. So that ratio, BUN to creatinine, if it's greater than 20, it suggests pre-renal. If it's less than 20, it tells me this is probably a kidney problem. Bell's palsy is typically the 7th cranial nerve. The difference between Bell's palsy and a stroke, Bell's palsy will affect the whole face, forehead, and eye. The biggest complication of Bell's is corneal ulcer because they sleep and that eye can't close. Salt, sarcoid, AIDS, Lyme disease, and tumor can cause Bell's palsy. It's typically a clinical diagnosis, treatment, antivirals, and steroids. We know that Guillain-Barré syndrome is linked to Campylobacter. It's linked to Campylobacter. And what's the most common infection linked with camping? STD. Just kidding. How do we know if it's a sick kid? Well, the mnemonic is tickle. Tone, irritability, consolability, cry, labor. Are they appropriately stimulated by the environment and suckling? Are they eating well? All right, folks, I hope this is helpful. This is the pre-video. I need you to watch this. I need you to master this stuff. Make flashcards. Your learning will go so much higher if you come into the course with this information. Study it. Master it. My name is John Belinsky from CME for Life. Our whole goal is to help you maximize your mind. I mean, that's my passion, my calling. Because if you don't know much about my story, I struggled as a learner. And I know what Einstein said is true, where he said, if you judge a fish by his ability to climb a tree, he's going to grow up his life feeling he was stupid. And that was my experience, okay, as a younger person trying to be educated in the traditional system. I like atraditional learning. It's my passion and calling. It's truly how we want to leave a legacy. How can I help you learn in a way that gets you the information so the end use is you help patients? So it's a passion and calling. My name is John Belinsky from See Me for Life. Thanks for watching.